So in the last video, we had a look at this here PIR sensor manufactured by HPM, and we had a close look at what's inside one of these, as well as the failure mode it had. And then we had a closer look at this here metal can, which is the pyroelectric sensor. Since making that video, I've been given this here PIR sensor. This one is manufactured by Robus and is a Proton Universal 360 degree PIR sensor designed for mounting on ceilings. And this particular unit has been given to me because it's broken. So in this video, we're going to try and repair it. But also, we'll take a look at the actual PIR sensor as well, because in the previous video I mentioned that there was such a thing as a quad-type pyroelectric sensor. And well, judging by the shape of the detection pattern of this unit, I suspect that we're going to see one of these inside. So let's take this thing apart. Taking the front bezel off, there's no screws underneath. However, there are three adjustment pots. One for lux, which is because this has day-night sensing. Another for sensitivity, and another for time, which is how long it spends on for. But on the back we can see there's four screws, as well as this nice little connection block for the wires. And this is only a three-pin device, one for the active in, one for neutral, and one for the active out, which is switched. And of course there's no earth because there's no exposed metalwork on this device. So taking those four screws out, and we can see what's inside. And there's even more than the previous PIR sensor. There's actually three of these rather large 16-pin SOIC devices, plenty of capacitors, probably for timing and bulk decoupling, as well as a nice fuse, the output relay, some X-class suppression capacitors, and of course the potentiometers. But taking a look at the others, I was expecting a single quad-type pyroelectric sensor, but actually they've gone and put three, I would presume, just normal dual-type pyroelectric sensors in at 120 degrees to get their 360-degree coverage. But this will certainly work as well, but I guess we're not going to take a look at a quad-type sensor today. Taking a look back at the datasheet now, I now realize I was rather misled by this figure here. We can see that at a ceiling height of, say, 3 meters, it's expected to have a spread of 18 meters. I now realize that this diagram is definitely not to scale. Here it is to scale. So yeah, it's definitely got a much larger range than I thought. You definitely can't achieve this sort of range without either some very fancy optics, or rather just shoving three of them on a PCB under the same optics, which is certainly going to get the job done. But unfortunately means we're not going to be looking at a quad-type sensor today. However, this PIR sensor still needs to be repaired. So let's see if we can identify the failure mode, because I was told this thing just behaves strangely and doesn't work properly. It's not that it doesn't work at all, or that it's done weird things, made a loud bang sound. It's just that it's not reliable. So I've got some test probes on the AC in as well as the neutral, and that's connected to this plug, and plugging it into 240 volts AC. There's no explosion. I heard some clicking, so it's doing something. Now let's get this flipped over because there's a LED on the other side. Plugging it in again, and yeah, there's some weird clicking, and this red light's flashing. Let me dim the light so you can see that better. So the red LED is flashing quickly. Looking at the manual, this appears to be the warm-up routine that goes for a minute. And after a minute, that light stops flashing. And if I bring my hand close to it, it does actually activate, although it doesn't seem to actually switch properly. And after it does it once, it doesn't seem to want to do it again. So there's some sort of weird thing happening here. I'm wondering if maybe the relay, is the relay closing, drawing too much power, and then browning out the power supply? That's the only thing I can imagine that would create this symptom. So I guess the first thing we're going to try is to check the power supply. Now, this thing uses a capacitive dropper power supply, which is non-isolated. It seems to use these two capacitors here. I'm not quite sure why there's two of them. It's probably just that one of them's for the control electronics and the other one is for the relay coil. So testing the first capacitor, we should get 100 nanofarads. And yeah, 32 is definitely not 100. That's the right thing, right? Yep. That's the 100 nanofarad capacitor. Yep, so that... it could be that it's in circuit, but that doesn't seem right. Checking the other one, this one should be 470 nanofarads. And it's... yeah, 383. Yeah, these capacitors have me a bit suspicious. So let me get these capacitors out and we can test them outside of the circuit. So I've got here this LCR meter, which is better than the DMM, and it's measuring 381 nanofarads. So yeah, that's definitely not 470. There's something wrong with this one. And the other one, which should measure 100 nanofarads, is 31.8. So yeah, both of these capacitors are just completely rooted, especially this 100 nanofarad one, which is actually about 32 nanofarads. This thing's going to cause all sorts of havoc in the circuit. It's just not going to supply enough current to run the circuit. So I reckon that's a pretty good indication that this is what the problem is. And of course, these capacitive dropper power supplies do actually fail quite often. You'll see a lot of YouTube videos and wiki articles and blog posts about people repairing these capacitive droppers because the capacitor has lost its capacitance. It's quite a common thing. So I really wouldn't recommend one of these capacitive dropper power supplies. They're just not very reliable. Although the advantage that they have is that they're absolutely dirt cheap. You really cannot beat the price point of a capacitor rather than an entire switch mode power supply. So that's why they get used all the time. But at the very least, it makes for a very easy repair. So I had a look around for some replacement capacitors, and I settled on the MKP339X2 series from Vishay. These are some quite nice capacitors. These are from a reputable brand, and they're rated to higher voltages than the previous ones. The previous ones were 275 volt AC rated. These ones are 310 volts AC rated. So these should last, hopefully, a lot longer than the previous ones. And of course, because these are used in a capacitive dropper, it's important to use the same values. Unlike bulk decoupling capacitors where you can just increase the capacitance value and increase the voltage rating, so long as they're at least a certain number, it's good enough. In this case, the capacitance value is very important because if you make the capacitance value too large, you'll pass too much current and you risk overheating the shunt regulator inside. So we're going to go for a 0.47 microfarad and a 0.1 microfarad, which is exactly the same as was in here before. And of course, I chose one with the correct case size and lead spacing so it would fit in the PCB. And just to be safe, I checked them on the LCR meter when I got them, and they were indeed the correct value within the tolerances of manufacturing. So it's just a matter of cleaning up those plated through holes to get the components in. Thankfully, I've repaired my desoldering gun since the last video. It's very important you keep your desoldering gun nice and clean. Make sure that there's absolutely nothing left in the tube, otherwise it will clog and you'll have a bad day. And apart from that, there's really nothing complicated about this repair. It's just a matter of soldering two components in, nice and easy. And now that I've got them in, we can see that they fit nicely. And they are indeed the correct height, so they won't interfere with the plastic enclosure. And then just putting it all back together and plugging it in. And I let it go through its 1 minute warm-up procedure. And if we listen carefully, we can hear it click when I put my hand over it. And I've spent several minutes waving my hands in front of this thing and taking them away, trying to catch this thing out, make it fail again, but I haven't made it fail again, so I think it's fixed now. So that was a rather nice repair, very easy to fault find, very obvious failure mode and very easy solution. And these capacitors were only about $1.50 each, which is quite nice because these things are about $60 new. So that's it for the repair, but let's take a look at these capacitors a bit closer whilst I've got them out, also because I was denied that quad-type pyroelectric sensor. So let's test these capacitors to the extreme and, let's just blow them up. So I've got here a 1.5 kilovolt peak-to-peak biphasic pulse. This is a 360 joule pulse delivered over 15 milliseconds. Actually, let's put this into perspective. Here is a quarter watt 56 ohm resistor, and yeah, it just explodes. Yeah, that's not a very happy resistor. You can see here in this microscope picture, the resistive element has just been completely vaporized off the resistor core. But also let's have a look at a 400 volt 4.6 microfarad capacitor out of a USB charger. And yeah, that thing never stood a chance either. So let's test out two other capacitors. This is exactly the same pulse, so I'm hoping we get some nice fireworks, although I am hoping that the Vishay one stands up a little bit better, and hoping that the Jimson brand one just catastrophically explodes everywhere. And let me do that again. Who's bloody well sold me capacitors that don't explode? Come on. So as you're probably screaming at the screen right now, these are of course X2 class safety capacitors. All of these funny markings on the side of them aren't just to make it look pretty. These are actually all sorts of compliance and regulatory markings that say that it complies with all sorts of safety standards that say it can withstand certain sorts of abuse. So in the case of these two capacitors that are X2 class rated, even this Jimson, I don't know, I've never heard of them before, but even this one is rated to withstand 1.2 kilovolts for a minute. And this Vishay one specifically says it withstands 24 pulses at 2.5 kilovolts. So unfortunately, I don't have anything that goes that high. I did pulse this thing 15 times and it didn't explode. So yeah, unfortunately, I can't make it explode. But I hope that this at least demonstrated that these little unassuming capacitors can actually put up a pretty good fight against what's on the other side of these outlets. The sort of stuff in our electrical distribution network is rather big and scary and can create all sorts of weird transients that have the opportunity to blow things up if it weren't for these little suppression capacitors. Although, of course, it's not just these capacitors that save your gadget from being exploded. There's, of course, also Y-class suppression capacitors, as well as varistors and PTCs and NTCs and, of course, fuses. And those are the components that will generally be absorbing the large pulses. These X-class capacitors are more so for EMI suppression, when another device nearby emits some sort of interference that could interfere with your device. But that's all nice and everything, but why is it that I just put 1.5 kilovolts through this capacitor and it didn't explode? In fact, it didn't even lose any capacitance. If it wasn't line transients that made this 100 nanofarad capacitor go to 32 nanofarads, what did? Because that's quite often what I see. People will say that these things get overvolted and they internally fuse and lose capacitance over time. So let's cut one of these open and see if we can find anything that's obviously wrong with it. These capacitors inside are just like any other normal metallized polypropylene capacitor. However, they of course need to withstand much higher voltages and energies. So the layer thickness is higher, but also they have much better potting in this epoxy and plastic shell. So I've got the capacitor out of the potting now and I've unwound a bit. And we can see, I don't know what I'm looking at actually. There seems to be some delamination going on here, but I have no clue what that means. However, thankfully I have this here failure diagram, This shows all sorts of different failure modes that can happen, as well as their causes. And of course our failure mode is the capacitance decrease one, and that seems to be caused by all sorts of different things. But I'm wondering if maybe humidity has something to do with it. Partly because looking back at the footage, we can see that there was actually this here void in the epoxy. So I'm wondering if moisture was able to more easily penetrate this. But this speculation is mostly driven by a video I saw on the EV blog channel, in which Dave Jones had an interview with Ron Demko from Kyocera AVX, in which he went through this document and had a talk about all the sorts of different failure modes, but specifically had a look at a capacitor that Dave Jones had out of a heater, which was a very similar capacitor, and had some rather similar sort of failure indicators as my capacitor. So I'm wondering if moisture was the cause, whether it was from poor encapsulation or from the manufacturing process, I have no clue. But I do recommend watching this video if you want to know more. Ron goes into quite a lot of detail about these safety capacitors and their failure modes, as well as a number of other different capacitor types. So I'll leave a link to that in the description, and that's it for this video, so thanks for watching.